Hi, everybody. Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Lexi Leban. I'm the executive director of the Jewish Film Institute, and I'm thrilled to welcome you to today's program, Unruly Women, Jewish Female Characters on TV. Every summer since 1980, JFI has presented the San Francisco Jewish Film Festival, and we couldn't imagine a summer without a festival. So we've created Synagogue Summer Days so that we could be together in community and conversation in a way that we can do it right now, first at the drive-in movies and now here in your living rooms. While we are really, really missing the Castro Theater right now, it has been exciting to see that thousands of you have tuned in from around the world. This is really breaking geographical barriers. And this is our closing day, so you still have until midnight to binge watch as much as you can in our digital screening room. Before we start, I'd like to thank the sponsors of today's program, the San Francisco Jewish Women's Fund, a program of the Jewish Community Federation and Endowment Fund, and all of you who have stepped up to support JFI during these challenging times. If you've not already done so, please consider making a donation so that we can be here online while we're still sheltering in place and then back in the theaters when we're ready to be in community together again. I'd also like to thank our sign language interpreters, Matt and Rebecca, for being here with us today, and our captioner, Patty. For those of you who want to ask questions, there's a Q&A box down at the bottom of your screen, and there's also a chat if you'd like to say hi and post comments. Today's conversation is part of a new series called Stories She Tells. This is a two-year initiative that shines an investigative and exploratory spotlight on the contributions of Jewish women in front of and behind the lens. We are taking the opportunity of our 40th anniversary year here in 2020 to look back and ask, where have we been and where are we going from here? This series is guest curated by Caroline Labresco, the founding director of the Sundance Women's Initiative and Sundance Catalyst, a senior programmer at the Sundance Film Festival for the past 18 years, and she is actively developing projects through her company, Gabbert Labresco Projects. She also has the distinction of being the former associate director of the San Francisco Jewish Film Festival. When Caroline and I first talked about this series, we both noted the extraordinary boom of Jewish women characters on TV and the rise of
Hello. I don't know. Hello is such a little word for such a big feeling. I want to say hello to you with all the letters in the alphabet. That would be a hello. Anyway, hello.
I'm from a little town called Larchmont, where if you're not married, if you're a girl, and you're over 21, you're better off dead.
She's an American princess and a disco queen. She's the Jewess in Jewess jeans.
Oh, what? What's wrong?
A bone sticking out of your back.
Okay, I dropped a few pounds. Go ahead, say it.
No,
I'm too thin.
No, you look great for somebody who hasn't had a decent meal in a year.
I am your mother, and I will control you till the day you die.
Ooh, the nanny gets to live here?
Is that a problem?
Oh, yeah, I'm sure I'm gonna miss being 29 and still living at home with my parents. But if it's best for the kids...
Well, maybe that's my decision. Well, maybe I don't need your money. Wait, I said maybe!
Charlotte, the Episcopalian princess, was reborn a Jew.
My Nana was a survivor of the Holocaust. Thank God she was at one of the better concentration camps.
I thought you might like to help me decorate it tonight. Mark our first Christmas together.
I'm Jewish.
I'm up at 6 a.m. every day. I have my protein shake with banana and flaxseed oil. And by 6:10, I'm on the elliptical.
You want props to move around? Well, I'm a human prop, and I'm sick of it.
Take a lap and cool down, Asian number one.
My name is Tina. Tina Cohen Chang.
We need to discuss your work habits.
Okay, sure. But after I take a quick nap, because ecstasy takes forever to leave my system.
I don't know what I can say. I'm American. I'm really not very Jewish. If my mother hadn't died having me, I could have been Marilyn instead of Rachel. No one would know the difference.
His name is Bryce, which, like, hello, good name. He works in product development, which is, like, perfect for me because I love products, and he's Jewish.
Can I be a Jew?
No.
Can I be a Jew?
No.
Can I be a Jew?
You really want this? Sincerely. Not because this one's trying to blackmail me for something stupid when I was 19, or for broccoli with your dinner. What is this for you?
Honestly, I think I found my people.
Because you two crazy kids want to get married in the confines of this shithole. Somehow you two managed to find each other again.
The day you were born was the best day of my life.
What was it like?
The day you were born, it was amazing.
You never even had a bat mitzvah.
I know, that's the point. Now I'm too old for one.
And you're too Jewish for a quinceañera. And you're not too old for a bat mitzvah. You could get bat mitzvahed at any age.
We Jews got a painful history.
Our parent just died.
There are no words.
And we say never to forget the pain, never to forget the shame. So our songs, they always sound the same.
Oh, my God.
Mom, she's a high-class waspy Jew, a Philadelphia queen from down the main line, King of Prussia Mall.
Aruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech Haolam Asher.
Our lifelines have been parallel like corduroys, but now we'll see whose bars will prevail in this beef up too hard as nails. She bruised from Scarsdale.
My mother first told me to keep my knees closed until there's a ring on my finger in the Catskills. Actually, she told me it was biologically impossible to have sex without a ring on your finger. Guess what, Mom? It's not.
Because an aggressive woman likes to be on top.
אין לי כוח להתחיל הכל מחדש. לי כוח לאהבה, לחתונה, לבית, לרעיתים, עוד משפחה, עוד ילדים, עוד חיים, אין לי כוח.
You must be Betty Friedan.
Shiva, but have you ever noticed that there is an inscription over the door that is incredibly highly creepy? Mm. What does it mean?
Don't you know? You're Jewishy.
Not by choice. Hey, come on. Religion is dumb as fuck, all right? It's racist, it's sexist. There's no money in it anymore.
You can know this, that I will always love you. But I will never forgive you.
Get
me. Sie sucht, dass ich fest kein Mund ist, sondern geht ihr Farb für mich.
There was a war there for 30 years, and my father was from there. He's an Eritrean Jew, and he came here to America, met my mama at a gas station, and booyah!
Hello, can you hear me okay? Yes. Okay, great. Hi, everybody. My name's Caroline Labresco, and I am professionally, I'm a film curator and a producer, but in my private life, I'm a TV junkie. And I became one in the last decade, not only because there's a plethora of great content, but because as a Jewish feminist woman, I'm now more likely to see myself on TV than in even the most enlightened independent art cinema. And who doesn't want to see themselves on screen reflected in this in the culture? I think we're starved for it, especially as Jewish women. As Jack Lacan said, we need to see ourselves mirrored. Otherwise, we have no sense of self. We're invisible. So in a way, TV is serious business. So as Lexi intimated, we're really excited to present a conversation about this incredible boom of women protagonists, Jewish women protagonists on television. So this conversation will explore why this boom of female protagonists, and what is the nature of these protagonists, and to what extent do they carry or cast off stereotypes that we've lived with for a long time. And also, as Lexi mentioned, the one person we really felt was equipped to guide us through this extremely complex terrain is Emily Nussbaum. And she's a critic. She's a critic who embraces television as an art in its own right, a medium that's alive and constantly changing its form as well as changing society. And she does it with a feminist lens, giving us the tools for reading women protagonists in a new light. From 2011 to 2019, Emily was the TV critic for The New Yorker, winning a Pulitzer Prize in 2016, and in 2018, publishing her book, I Like to Watch, Arguing My Way Through the TV Revolution. If you haven't read it, I highly recommend this. It's full of incredible insights and essays. And then this year, she's on leave from The New Yorker, writing a book on early reality television. Afterwards, she will return to The New Yorker in an expanded role as a staff writer. We are so lucky to have Emily here with us. Please welcome Emily Nussbaum.
Hello.
Hi. Hello.
Hi. Hi, thanks for having me. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you. Thanks so much for being here. And just before I delve into our many topics, I just want to remind the audience out there whom we can't see, so we're just going to talk to each other, but know that we're thinking of you. But please feel free to ask questions. You can submit your questions through the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And then in about 55 minutes, we will turn to you and your questions. So please hang with us, and then we'll open it up to all of you who are there. So I'm so excited for this, Emily, because I've been dying to talk about this for so long. I've been intuiting it, but now I feel like we can finally really delve consciously into this question. So, in the last 7 or 8 years, is it fair to say that there's been a kind of a boom of explicitly female Jewish protagonists on TV? I mean, let me list some that are just top of mind. We begin with Girls, Inside Amy Schumer, the characters on Orange Is the New Black, Transparent in 2014, Broad City in 2015, Crazy Ex-Girlfriend 2015, Unreal 2015, Grace and Frankie, Better Things comes along in 2016, Marvelous Mrs. Maisel in 2017, along with Big Mouth, Russian Doll, Unorthodox, and now The Plot Against America. Is this a boom? Is it fair to say this is unprecedented?
Well, I think that there is a tremendous boom. I mean, there's actually been a boom in expansion of representation across TV in a bunch of different categories, but it's definitely true that the specific thing for Jewish women has been women that are characters that call themselves Jewish or explicitly Jewish in the text. It's not a coded thing. There have been Jewish women making television from the beginning, but as we'll talk about, there are a whole different bunch of ways in which that Jewishness was expressed. But I actually think that it's like the manyness of this that's the exciting part, because it's freed up all of these creators and the characters that they have to be more than simply the one, which means this enormous pressure to be a role model. Like the shows that you've mentioned, which are actually only part of the shows, because those are the big ones that it's really nuts once you start brainstorming it. The number of them has allowed shows to be rude, be confusing, be shocking, be divisive, and also be heartwarming, be silly, be dramatic. And that's what happens when you get more than one person as a mirror. You actually get to be specific and take risks. And
the manyness. The manyness. The manyness. Yeah. Okay. Great. So let's talk about. So this moment, what is different about it? How did this happen? You know, we talk about the streaming platforms and how the marketplace itself changed and created more creative freedom. But why now? Why this flood of shows right now? What is happening?
Well, as I said, I think part of this is actually a subset of a greater diversification of the kinds of shows that get made and the kinds of people that they get made about. It's not like a utopian situation. It's not like all of TV's problems of representation are solved, but there definitely has been an expansion. And whenever I talk about TV, I say, you know, you can't separate TV as an art form from TV as a technology. And it's absolutely true that the range of, you know, a lot of this stuff started with the emergence of small cable channels, streaming networks and things like that, which allowed people to make shows that were for smaller audiences. So some of the shows that are my favorite shows in this group, like Crazy Ex-Girlfriend is a brilliant show. I mean, that's a great breakthrough show that I was like, someone made a show just for me. It's very exciting. It got tiny ratings. And so there's part of it where it's like, well, why didn't that exist on NBC in 1987? Because TV was a completely different medium at the time. And the way shows were made just didn't allow for making something risky and niche. But I think there's also just been, I mean, one of the things that happens is honestly, one person makes something and it inspires other people. And this is a longer conversation, but I think that there are times that people make a certain kind of show that takes different kinds of risks that TV never used to take, and other creators are inspired to try to push through the many barriers there are. That said, I have to say, there were, and this is different than other groups, there were Jewish women making television from the beginning of television.
Yes.
And it's one of the things that I think makes this conversation about representation different, because with a lot of groups that were not on TV, it was partially because there were no writers making those shows. But like right from the start of TV, you know, with Gertrude Berg and making Molly Goldberg, and what was the show called actually? It was
The Goldbergs.
The radio show
was called The Rise of the Goldbergs.
I was noticing that. And it changed a little bit from the radio to the TV anyway, in making it more universal and patriotic a show. But you know, like on your show of shows, you had Lucille Callan. Like there were female Jewish writers. Women in general were the vast minority in TV writers, but they were there all along, but they had to express themselves in different forms, not necessarily through characters that were like the main Jewish woman at the center of the show.
I was reading about the majority of writers of Rhoda were Jewish women.
Yeah, that's not surprising to me, and that's interesting. Rhoda is such a fascinating character. I'm sure you guys all know, like Rhoda, Mary Tyler Moore, Mary's best friend. It's interesting. I wish I'd watched that show more when I was coming up. I realized I was rewatching it for this, and it was not a show, like just given my age, for some reason I skipped it in a funny way, and I honestly think part of it was that I had a false impression of Rhoda based on the most negative version of her, which is that she was a Jewish woman who was always saying, I'm fat and nobody likes me. But one of the things I realized while I was working on this was how much the way she's characterized in the pilot, which is this sort of extremely rude, obnoxious, almost like chaos energy, was changed by the women writers who created her. And I was watching an interview actually with Treva Silverman, who wrote for the show. And she was talking about, I think it's the third episode, and it's called Today I Am a Ma'am, like Today I Am a Man.
Yes.
And she says that she literally was like, Valerie Harper is a warm and charming person, and I want to write the character in a way that's a little more tender and a little less like just a steamroller. And I, you know, the character changed over the course of the show, and the writers and the women who worked on the show were very affected by feminism at the time, and they brought that into the writer's room. So that's a great, it's a great show, but it's also a great text because it's literally like this imprint of the period and the way things were changing for women and for TV.
Right, right. And I mean, of those, you know, you said, you know, rightfully that the shows that I listed are sort of the greatest hits, and there's so many more, but of those, I listed 14 shows, and then I counted that 12 out of the 14 are made by women creators,
yeah,
women showrunners. And I just want to talk about that, because I understand that streaming and the way that technology has changed television to create more representation, more creative control by the folks writing, by the diverse folks writing. But I wanted to talk about those creators and what made, it just seemed like they were all at the ready when the technology was ready. Is that, it's just like they were all like waiting there. They had been writers on other shows, but then they were waiting there ready to pounce.
It's funny. I know some women writers in Hollywood who are like a little older than the people who broke through, and they definitely, there's this sense of mild rancor because it's like the doors opened a bit, and then there was a lot of talent that was available that was able to make its way. I mean, I don't have, if I understood the television industry, if I understood anything about economics and corporations, I would not be a TV critic, because there's a certain sense of mystery to why things break through and what makes it. But one thing is that thing of people inspiring other people, I do think is true. Like Girls, when Girls came out, and I don't think people think of Girls as a tremendously Jewish show, but Lena Dunham herself is half Jewish, and the show was, as she's talked about, like half Jewish girls, half non-Jewish girls. And I am familiar with every reaction to Girls that people have ever had. But I think sometimes people have trouble going back in time and remembering what it was like for that show to come out, because not just the way the characters were on the show, but the fact that it was sort of an auteurist show by a young woman creating a set of young women who had this kind of like rude and complicated and off-putting and funny but dark funny vision inspired other creators. And so their name is now Joey Soloway. At the time, yes, Joel Soloway, when created Transparent, was directly inspired by Girls in an envy way, where it was like, well, if she can do it, like I want to be able to do it. Because a lot of the people who created those shows there's a million projects in Hollywood that never got made. And, you know, some of them were about this exact subject matter, but essentially I think once the door opened a bit and once the economics allowed for more risk-taking, lower budget shows, you could get stuff like that green-lighted. But there is a mystery to it that can't really be nailed down. It's true, though, that there's like a range. You know, it's Jenji Kohan making shows.
She's royalty. I mean, she's TV royalty in her family. But with Joey Soloway and Lena, they come from my world, which is independent film, scrappy as hell. You know, you just kind of make it happen. And that, I think, plays a role in their ability to get these totally groundbreaking shows off the ground. But yeah, there's also a mystery.
That's the thing. It'd be nice to come up with the solution that gets interesting and good and challenging art onto television. But if people knew it, they would probably try to do it more. It just doesn't always work like that. And frankly, the reason that some shows that there are shows that there's a show that's a one season show that I love that has a Jewish main character, huge, that's by Winnie Holtzman, who helped create like My So-Called Life and all of these kinds of shows. Her daughter, I'm blanking on her name, but she made the show that was a one season show about a fat camp. It has a great main character who's a Jewish character played by Nikki Blonsky. It didn't get the ratings. So, you know, we could be talking about that show.
Right.
It's which shows make it through. Anyway, I'm just bemoaning the difficulty of getting things to actually last.
Yes, but which is why it's all the more of a kind of, it's all the more wondrous, you know, that we have literally dozens of shows with, well, at least a dozen and a half shows with female protagonists in the last 7-8 years that have come to us by women creators. But back to sort of the ratings, I wonder, you know, this question of like, part of the fear of the 80s and 90s, I mean, I think in the 90s, we can say that there were characters who were explicitly Jewish, you know, Grace on Will and Grace and the nanny, and we're going to go back and talk about those a little more later. But at the same time, there was a lot of muting, you know, of Jewish identity. There were Jewish writers everywhere, but there was this kind of fear that Jewishness, and especially female Jewishness, would be somehow off-putting to a general audience. But now we have these shows where audiences are receiving them. They're receiving them and loving them. And is that, what's that about? Why are they suddenly ready? What's going on in the culture?
Well, one thing is I have to say, again, the reason that I think in the 80s and 90s, and I think this is absolutely true, there's a million characters. And it's actually, in a weird way, when I was looking back at the history, I was like, the history of those shows in the 80s and especially in the 90s, and we can talk about things like the Jewish characters on Friends and about Elaine Bennis on Seinfeld.
We will talk about coding.
You can literally get into arguments about the nature of the characters and whether they're Jewish and stuff. And you know the old expression that's, you know, write Yiddish, cast British. Mm-hmm. And there's definitely, I don't think it's a question of whether the characters would have been accepted. I mean, some characters were accepted. The nanny was an overtly Jewish character that was accepted. And as I say, a lot of the really great shows here had relatively small audiences. So, you know, Rachel Bloom, that show is an inspiring show and a great show. And it will sort of last forever because the technology has enabled it to be something that people can revisit. But did it reach a broad mass audience? No, it did not, in fact. And Broad City, I would say, is probably the same thing. But, you know, from my perspective, as somebody who cares about good TV, that doesn't matter to me. Like, all I want is for the systems to work well enough that good shows get through. And there are shows that, it's funny, with streaming systems, you literally don't know what the ratings are. I mean, this is the problem with TV in general, is that the amount, the ratings and the qualities of the show were historically such overlapping categories for the people who put out TV that it was hard to separate. At this point, to me, the freeing thing is that you can actually put shows that got low ratings at the center of a conversation like that, because from my perspective, those are the most important shows. Mm-hmm. The most important shows are the most interesting shows, or the riskiest shows, or the, you know, and so that's the other thing. A lot of the shows that we're talking about, like must-see TV shows, like Friends and Seinfeld, I do have this question, like, if those characters had been more overtly Jewish, would it have affected the sense that the show was a show that everybody could love? You'd have to just do some sort of sliding doors history and rewrite it. And also, it's not necessarily like, it's complicated what's considered universal. I'm sorry to skip to Elaine Bennis, but I'm just gonna, is it okay if I just... Because Elaine Bennis, when Elaine appeared on Seinfeld, I mean, I have a lot of hair and glasses and I'm from New York. And I saw her on the show, and like a lot of other women like me, I was like, oh, there she is. Like, finally, there's a Jewish New York woman of this particular type who's on television. And she's played by Julia Louis-Dreyfus, and the clothes she wears and everything seemed just right. And over the course of the show, you slowly realize that not only is this character not Jewish, but there's an entire episode about her having shiks appeal and attracting Jewish men, and she's not Jewish. So it's just, there's just this contradictory text. And also, the show itself is a show that feels to me like a very Jewish humor show. Like, but the characters themselves are marked, not just the women, but like, you know, like George.
No one can agree.
George's parents are, no, in some ways, I think this makes the show very effective. I don't mind it. It's not as though, but I will say that with Elaine, I'm of two minds about it, because there is something very weird about having a character seem so Jewish and be literally explicitly non-Jewish. And of course, sometimes the opposite thing happens. A character is marked as Jewish, but is either played by a non-Jewish person in a way that makes them seem explicitly non-Jewish or creates some sort. So that interaction between who wrote it, who it's about, and who's playing it, and what the character is often not such an easy thing to sort out. And in the case of Elaine, I have to say, it's just classic TV, you know, collaboration, because that character is based on a variety of different women. I mean, it's partially based on Carol Leifer, who is Jewish, but it's also partially based on, I'm blanking on her name, but Richard Yates' daughter was, I think Larry David's ex-girlfriend. Mm-hmm. And so there's the backstory for that character where her mm-hmm. father is this elite WASPy novelist comes from a non-Jewish woman. So you can't say, you know, this character should be Jewish. But I think at that point in history, especially because I think a lot of people felt this incredible craving, there is a sense of disappointment where you're like, what? And when it comes to Friends, I felt that actually I didn't care about it until like 5 years ago, when weirdly I was on Twitter and people started arguing about whether the character played by Jennifer Aniston was Jewish. Mm-hmm. And I realized partway through the conversation that a character who seemed to me to be so obviously Jewish, like a stereotypical character who had been just brought to life and illuminated and made like huge and joyful and interesting by a brilliant comic actress. To me, it was like obvious, like those are three Jewish friends from the Five Towns. Yeah. I realized when I was talking online that because she was not clearly Jewish, or she didn't talk about her Jewishness, there were a bunch of viewers who were not Jewish who interpreted her relationship with Ross as the relationship between a nerdy Jewish guy mm-hmm. who had a crush on a shiksa blonde cheerleader. And yes. it actually really bothered me because I realized there's limited enough representation of Jewish women on TV that people didn't have the ability to imagine like a hot, vain, popular cheerleader girl as a Jewish character, and they left just enough ambiguity for people to read different ways. And it actually changed my mind about it because I was like, oh, it made me wish. And so then I went on this hunt to look for signs of Jewishness in Rachel Green. And in fact, I think you can pretty much clearly demonstrate that that character is Jewish because, among other things, she talks about her Bubba Ida, and somebody sent me she wears a Star of David. So, but there's a little bit strange to go on like a hunt to play Jew, not a Jew with a TV character, but that's what you get when you don't have a lot of people on TV.
That's how starved we are. And for our generation where we were, that was literally like formative, was it our 30s or our 20s, whatever it was. we're starved for it. And I went down that rabbit hole too, to try to deter for this, preparing for this conversation, is she or isn't she? Are Ross and Monica Geller, are they or aren't they? And I think what I found was that they both definitely have one Jewish parent. The other parent is questionable.
Yeah, so, that's true. And the other funny thing is that the two Jewish women characters on the show are played by non-Jews, and the one non-Jewish woman character on the show is played by a Jew. So, you know, it's like, I'm personally all for cross, I'm not a big stickler about cross-identity character playing, but there are exceptions to this. And I think sometimes it creates interesting ambiguities. Like we were talking earlier off screen about how, you know, Maude, who I don't believe is a Jewish character, but it's played by Arthur and based mm-hmm. on Francis Lear. So like there's this in between category.
Yes. And it makes me think, was that a requisite for a hit show? But then you do have Grace Adler and you do have Fran Drescher.
Yes.
So what the hell is going on? And that's partly why this conversation is so rich, because what I thought I would find in exploring this topic was that we would start with like terrible stereotypes at the beginning of television that then were like vanquished, that evolved, you know, beautifully into a kind of a nuanced new Jewish woman who's explicitly Jewish. But it's not like that, because Gertrude Berg starts, you know, in the 20s on her radio show with Molly Goldberg, and then it becomes national television from 49 to 56. And she is explicit, she is blatant, she is out there as a Jewish woman. She is, and we could talk a lot about—
She's blatant. But the thing about that character, and I love that show and that character and the legacy of that's very important, but she's also, and I mean this not in a negative way, she's propaganda. Because the goal of the character is to have a portrait of a Jewish woman in a Jewish immigrant family as positive and American. And I know that they didn't, it's not like they were having conversations on the show about socialism. Like, you know, the characters—
It was an apolitical
show that was meant to show not only that you would identify with the characters of but that they were patriotic and they were American, and there was no line between being Jewish and being American. And it was a really valuable show in that way. And she was important. I mean, this is a period in television where it wasn't like you were going to have an anti-hero character Jewish mother. It was a very— I'm not saying it was a negative thing, but I'm just saying there's definitely a period early on where the foreignness of it. The thing you're talking about stereotypes is, I think, really interesting, because it's true. You can't draw some sort of clear through line where it moves through. But I will say there is a set of Jewish stereotypes, one of which is about the Jewish American princess, which is about the spoiled girl who is like sexless and materialistic and all of that kind of thing. And then the horrible, mean Jewish mother. Mm-hmm. And those are real stereotypes that are sometimes reflected in TV characters. And interestingly to me, they don't really come from the non-Jewish world. They come from Jewish men. They come from Jewish male art. Jewish male mid-century art often was kind of obsessed with these two kind of insidious stereotypes of two kinds of negative Jewish women. So you see a lot of Jewish women artists working in response to that kind of thing. So I don't think there's a way to talk about Joan Rivers without talking about Jewish American princess stuff, because that's what she was both opposing at the beginning of her career, playing into, you know, all of these kinds of things. So the funny thing is, it's like the stereotypes, I think, were allied with a lot of Jewish male writers for TV. So to the extent that they showed up on television, I think it's not a question of anti-Semitic non-Jews imposing Jewish stereotypes. It's like sometimes there are like insider stereotypes. And so I think that's present. But I have to say, some of my favorite modern characters are completely like, you had a brief, I think there was a brief clip in there of, what's her name I think it's on Parks and Recreation.
Mona Lisa Saperstein.
So amazing character. And yes, it's like a minor character who's always going money, and she's hilarious.
Money. And sex, money. So it's like there's these, all of these stereotypes are, so I think that I want to talk about that kind of extreme treatment of a stereotype, like the kind of the re-ownership, reclaiming of the stereotype and then kind of exploding it by intensifying it. But I want to talk about that in relation to Crazy Ex-Girlfriend.
A show which, by the way, I mean, I personally have no problem with the title. It's a classical situation in which the title itself made people think, oh, this is going to be a misogynist show. I'm not interested.
Right.
Right from that, even before you get to the Jewishness.
Totally. Yeah, let's talk about Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. So I was going to, it's funny how these conversations, like you plan kind of a structure for the conversation, then it has its own intrinsic structure, which is so much better than anything one can plan for. But when you bring up Mona Lisa Saperstein, I really wanted to hear your theory of this idea of that I think Crazy Ex-Girlfriend does too, where both of those, you know, both the Rebecca Bunch character and Mona Lisa Saperstein, and we could probably find a few others, they take these really intense Jewish stereotypes of kind of oversexed, of demanding, of needy, of controlling, of self-absorbed, of too muchness, which is something I often see in Jewish female protagonists. It's to me, there's something new going on here where they're not just tacitly employing or utilizing these stereotypes. They're utilizing them and subverting them in the same breath. Well, and let's talk about Crazy Ex-Girlfriend.
Because I want to say, like, yeah. Mona Lisa Saperstein is a stereotype and a hilarious one. And it doesn't actually subvert it. It's literally just such a great performance and so funny. And it's very freeing to actually be able to be a comic character and not have to have every character be a role model. It's a minor character on the show and it's playing off a stereotype, and I love it. Crazy Ex-Girlfriend is one of the richest, I mean, Rachel Bloom plays one of the richest characters on television, and also complicated because she's a mentally ill character whose fascination with musicals and romantic comedies and whose intensity and too muchness simultaneously suggests what she has, which is she's borderline, right, is what she ends up being diagnosed with. And the Jewishness of it, which plays into it because she is a very specific character and one that I have some identification with, not in terms of everything about her, but like she's from Scarsdale. I'm from Scarsdale. And so to watch a show that literally has a rap battle between two girls from Scarsdale who were academic foes, it's just, I really felt watching it like part of it's just because it's good. It's not because it's great representation. But the other part of it was I was like, oh my God, this is the most specific song I've ever heard in my life. Like she literally says that she slept with her boyfriend at the matzo ball. Like it's like these, they make jokes about, you know, you're tripping like birthright. Like it's like very specific kind of humor. And that to me is, it's the exact opposite of the stuff we were talking about before, which is the need, even if you had a Jewish character, to kind of paper over these granular specificities and to make it broad enough that people can relate. The other thing is that that character and several of these characters are part of a wave, and it's not only Jewish women, but there's a lot of Jewish women involved.
Right.
of unruly characters, but also characters that are in different ways. And I think anti-hero is not that useful a category, but it does come to me as a female wave that came in the wake of shows like The Sopranos that allowed there to be male characters that people were disturbed by, but also attracted to and fascinated by, and that were not good. These are a different kind of not good person, and her messiness is literally the subject of that show. And in a weird way, her being the protagonist is the subject of the show because she sees herself as the protagonist. I mean, the whole thing is like, it's a great show.
Really, because it's performing protagonism and both.
Well, it's
in
like
the narrative, but also
constructing the idea of thinking of yourself as, and you know, she literally has a song where she says, I'm the villain of my own story. She realized that she's acting in villainous ways where she thought she was the romantic heroine. And a lot of the best female TV has been playing off these things. Not all of it is about Jewish female characters. Like I would say Sex and the City played off rom-com and fairy tale stuff, and Jane the Virgin plays off telenovelas. So this kind of meta commentary about female narratives is big. When it's about a Jewish character, it also ends up weaving in this really powerful way, the notion of that self-consciousness of, you know, how do I come across? And, you know, some of this is about seeming too Jewish. And that's why that's why a show like, for instance, Broad City is so satisfying. That's not a meta show. That's just a show which is about two hilarious Jewish women who are just, that's like baked in. Like it just expects you to go along for the ride. It's just like a stoner comedy about two great, and it doesn't have that anti-hero quality. So the fact that you get both of these things during this period, I mean,
extraordinary. It's extraordinary.
It's amazing. Yeah, it's great. It's exciting.
It is really exciting. The reason why I say, I just want to go back to Crazy Ex-Girlfriend and the stereotyping that's in it, because I really want us to wrestle with this for 1 minute, which is, because I've read, the Jewish press, is, as you noted earlier, is obsessed with, is this good for the Jews? But I've read some accounts that see Rebecca Bunch and see Crazy Ex-Girlfriend as promulgating damaging stereotypes.
Right, right.
And I find this fascinating because for me, the only way I can describe it is that she embraces the stereotypes, embodies the stereotypes, and consciously comments on the stereotypes by making musical numbers, you know, remember that we suffered, you know, or whatever. Or her mother, played by Tova Feltschuh, who's like really embodies a terrible Jewish mother, like a cloying, controlling, difficult, withholding Jewish mother. So there is a consciousness about stereotypes here, and there is about using them and finding formal techniques for subverting them.
And there's also a cathartic not giving a damn about the idea of like, does this look good? Because some of this is really about spilling dirty laundry, because, you know, being able to talk about that kind of ugly family dynamic is the exact opposite of what felt really valuable about the Goldbergs at the beginning of TV history, which is presenting a really positive portrait of a Jewish family. I mean, I think there's space for both things. Like the Goldbergs on network TV is a pretty positive portrait of a Jewish family, but being able to show somebody unhappy with her mother in this specific way, and also frankly, not to have to have that main character have to be inspiring to women, like makes her inspiring to women. Like it's weird, like she did. And we could compare, by the way, to a show that I know a lot of people love, and I'm not telling them not to love it. I'm not a fan of Mrs. Maisel. And part of my problem with that show is that that show, the entire story is about erasing all of the, I mean, it changes a little bit later on, but especially for the first season, it's about celebrating her as the prettiest, the best, the most perfect, the person who created a tight 10 in 10 minutes, basically. So hilariously funny, everybody loves her. And to me, instead of that being inspiring or joyful, I found it both cloying and anxiety provoking. And I actually had problems with the portrait of Jewishness in that show. And weirdly, I feel like it was Oppositeville, because I felt no problem with what was happening in Crazy Ex-Girlfriend. Whereas in Maisel, I felt like it in a lot of ways, not completely, but especially with her husband's family, I felt like it treated them in a cartoonish way that felt like a theme park version of Jewishness, and bugged me and felt, you know, bothered me in a couple of ways. And it was partially because I'm extremely interested in that period and the idea of female comedy. And sure. So I felt like there was a way in which, because she was presented as a superhero who was really unaffected by any kind of misogyny, she would do this positive comedy that everybody loved. She was like, you're so beautiful and funny. And the actual version of that is Joan Rivers, all of whose comedy was about how ugly and undoable she was. So
how the world.
So when I compare those two shows, for some people, Maisel is definitely their taste, but I found it, you know, frustrating precisely for those reasons. And also, straightforwardly, although I think the actress is a wonderful and charming person, the fact that she looks so explicitly non-Jewish and people are constantly praising her on the show for being the prettiest Jewish woman ever compared to the other actresses who are cast with Jews is its own problem. So this is a larger thing, but frankly, the fact that that kind of all of these shows exist at once is encouraging to me. And the only thing that really bugs me is when people look at Maisel and say, finally, Jewish representation on TV. That's right, the only thing. Right. And that's one of many.
There's so much in your essay, I think it was in 2013? Your essay on Sex and the City, where you, was it 13 or 16?
I'm not sure.
Your essay on Sex and the City, when you proclaim Carrie Bradshaw as the first female anti-hero on television, helped me so much, and I think helped so many people frame how we all have misread female characters on TV, and helps us understand how to read them. So I think the most interesting characters in this pantheon that we're talking about, and Mrs. Maisel is not an anti-hero. We could talk about Crazy Ex-Girlfriend as an anti-hero. She's somebody. Let's talk about first, just really quickly, will you explain to the audience, what is an anti-hero? Before we,
I think people have different definitions of this. I have my own specific definition of this, which is that it's a character who is does bad things, but is attractive and sympathetic to the audience, that causes the audience to have a divided response to them. Like, they're not a villain in the story. They actually have enough magnetism that despite their bad behavior, they cause this internal sense of like confused, excited allure. I think that that's actually the driving force to a lot of these characters. And there are good shows that do this and there are bad shows. There are shows that really just glamorize crappy behavior. But one of the things that I think has been very valuable about it for TV, and you can see this in a brilliant show like The Sopranos, is that it changed the model for television, which is that television always had to soothe you, this was for many decades for a bunch of different reasons, but it had to have enough closure that you would invite the person back. You could never be really upset by them because you needed to keep inviting them into your living room. So
that's right.
Though,
we're very comfortable with it in cinema, watching films, of course.
Well, they leave after 2 hours.
They leave after 2 hours.
You have to commit to for years.
For until a decade ago, we were not comfortable. Or when was Sex and the City? Sorry.
That was all late 90s. There were a lot of shows like that.
It's been 20 years where we've had female anti-heroes. And that's kind of, we're getting comfortable with it. And part of the resistance to Hannah Horvath and Girls was about them being anathema because they didn't, they made us uncomfortable.
And that's I think there's just a tradition in female culture, and that includes things like romantic comedies and books that are aimed at women audiences and stuff. And I mean, I have my own thing about this. I think that there's this training that a lot of women viewers get that you're supposed, and it's funny because that it feels very different now when you read it, but in my piece about Sex and the City, I say that women are trained to watch a lot of movies and go, in an identification way, like it's your girlfriend, and go, oh, me too, me too. But now me too sounds different post 2017. But I think that the thing about Carrie Bradshaw, who we can actually talk about in terms of like, she's not a Jewish character, okay? But Sarah Jessica Parker reads in certain ways as Jewish on screen and is half Jewish herself. So it's I can't actually think of a lot of Jewish themes in that show other than Charlotte having converted, and that's a whole different thing. But yes, the main thing about that show is that Carrie makes you anxious. I like sometimes characters that make you anxious. Yeah. And a lot of the Jewish women protagonists that I find the most interesting about the recent years are not ones that offer easy identification, but that challenge the viewer in this way. Yes. I'm not saying that's the only way to do things, but to me, it's some of the most interesting art. And it's because it actually breaks the rules of TV that, you know, the historical rules of TV.
To become that
the character has to be nice and acceptable. And some of that is like an overlap between Jewish identity and female identity. You know?
Yes, yes. And there is a kind of way in which Jewish women are innately unruly for, we can, that's a whole other conversation, but it sort of dovetails with this time of female anti-heroes and mess and the allowance for messy female characters.
One of the things that's so great, I don't know whether are Jewish women intrinsically unruly? Like,
I think that they're or at least in the history of stereotyping, that's how we're seen. That's how we've always been seen. But I think that there is also a way in which there are, you know, I can't generalize about all Jewish women. It's a good point. It's a good point. But I know
what you're talking about.
I know a lot of Jewish women who identify with parts of these stereotypes, which are self-absorbed, you know, sometimes self-absorption, sometimes unruliness, sometimes messiness, sometimes outspokenness, loudness.
I just read an article in praise of Susie Essman from Curb Your Enthusiasm. And you know, she's a real bitch. She's great. And part of the thing is that her presence in the show is very unapologetic. And certainly somebody could be like, my God, what a horrible stereotype. But that actress is just so incredible on the show. And she, the thing is, she's there to blast back at Larry David. So it's not, people would analyze it different ways, but I think that the historical thing in Jewish identity in the United States, which is a little bit, has that thing of like, ugh, somebody's being too, not only too openly Jewish, but too much, like tacky. You know, there's something very liberating about a comic character who gets to be all those things and doesn't apologize for them, where there's no flattening or occlusion in that character. And Susie is like that. So some of the characters we're talking about, our main characters, are very layered. But other characters, I think there's, you know, like having like the Bugs Bunny chaos role is not something to spit at. And it that's in itself like a liberating kind of thing, so on some of these shows. Mm-hmm.
Going back to this idea of anti-heroes and how we relate to flawed characters and the question of empathy and how characterizations work, like how protagonists get drawn and the way that the audience responds to that is, I wanted to just turn toward Transparent, which is another deeply layered show and one that where critics are all over the map in terms of the extent to which they revere the show, and also often correlated to whether or not they see the characters as solipsistic and self-absorbed to the point of no return. Yes. Versus those like you and many others who see the characters as multifaceted, who see them as, you know, the fact that the show is critical of them, of their self-absorption, of their narcissism, allows us to the show doesn't look away, so we don't have to look away, to borrow your phrasing. And so my question is, I want to talk about these characters and in relation to the question of anti-heroes, and also in relation to the question of intractable stereotypes, like Shelley Pfefferman, the mother, you know, all of them exhibit Jewish woman stereotype traits in different ways. And yet, what does the show do with them? So Shelley, I mean, we could talk about Shelley as a kind of, you know, a needy kind of controlling, slightly overbearing mother. We can talk about Allie as the exhibiting stereotype traits such as masculinity, such as self-absorption, such as oversex. And the masculinity thing, I want to talk to you about this new stereotype I found from medieval Europe called the beautiful Jewess. And I want to talk to you about them in relation to Broad City, but it was like completely fascinating.
Let's just talk about Transparent for a second. Transparent is no doubt an enormously divisive show. I love the show. Yes. I actually don't think there's any question that those characters actually are solipsistic, narcissistic nightmares. The thing that is so magical about the show to me are two things. One of them is the specificity thing we were talking about. I'm like, are those shows stereotypes? Those shows are really, those characters are really specific people. Like, they are not cartoons. They may be repulsive to a lot of people and they may make people anxious, but they're specific. Not only are they based to some degree on their creator's family, but on top of that, I remember when I watched the show the first time when they're sitting around the table, they're all getting stuff on their face. They're making these weird Holocaust jokes. It's very unsettling. And I was watching it and they're, you know, they're sort of in the vaguely like arts industry kinds of stuff. And there's all the specific LA stuff. And I was watching it and I was just like, these are LA Jews in a way that I've never seen on TV. Like, I actually felt like I was like, this is a specific sense of humor that kids of that age have with each other. It may be a specific family with its own pathologies and joys and all that kind of stuff. But that's, I think, what makes it different than an expression of stereotypes. Shelley starts on that show as, it's weird. I felt like the creators really went out of their way to think about who is Shelley? Like, where does a person like Shelley come from? But you're right that, like, when I first saw her, I felt this kind of shock of recognition because there are definitely women that I've known that are like that. She had very buzz hair and she talked in this very aggressive way. And I did feel this feeling of like, yeah, that's sort of real, but is it crossing a weird line? I think the longer the show went on, the more it thought about, like, where did Shelley's behavior come from? And one of the most brilliant episodes on that show is the flashback episode where it talks about Shelley's history. And, you know, in ways that I think a lot of people found offensive, that show is also really clear about, I mean, first of all, that whole show is about metaphors about queerness and Jewishness and the idea that those two identities are woven together. It's the thesis of the show. And it goes so far as to just be like, the Holocaust is like a metaphor for, like, people have problems with that. I get it. It has a whole song called Joyocaust in the final season, which is questionable. But that is, to me, the power of the creativity of that show, is that it actually does cross those lines. But the one thing I would say is just the criticism of it based on the idea that they're stereotypes, I think that's wrong. I think the fact that the characters are unsettling and one of the things that to me is the mark of how good that show is that Sarah, the other sister, who's is very, you know, she's largely like feminine, spoiled mom who, like, I think I would find a character like that really annoying in real life. Like, she's the kind of person who drives me crazy. And I find that character so sympathetic on the show. And it's just, that's to me a particular kind of miracle of a show that can take a character where you should find them awful and selfish, and then almost against your will, draw them into an empathetic connection with them. So that's on that show. But you were going to talk about what were you going to say about, it was something about the idea of the beautiful Jewess. Is that a,
yeah, I mean, when I read about it in relation to Broad City, an academic wrote an essay about Broad City as an example of a transformation of the beautiful Jewess stereotype. And what this stereotype was, it starts in 1292 in Germany, and it's in Italian, French, British literature. The beautiful Jewess, you know, Belle Jewess or whatever. It's basically how sexually oversexed, sexually exotic, oriental, dark hair, dark eyes, alluring, you know, seductive Jewish woman. You want to have sex with her, but it's belying, underneath it is a monstrous masculinity, and that's deceitful. This essay by, his name's Jonathan Bramfman, he's a professor at William & Mary. He writes about queerness and Jewishness and feminism and race. And he basically says that what's so extraordinary about Broad City, and it, of course, Broad City does many things, but this is just one interesting facet, is that they have instead of this dichotomy of the kind of the sexual siren who's actually a monster, they exhibit the behaviors of masculinity with glee, with absolute glee, and without apologizing, and they see themselves as sexually attractive and alluring. So it's like this merging of these two facets of this damaging stereotype.
I'm gonna reject this theory. I just do. Okay. It's a fascinating thing. No, I totally, I know a little bit about the stereotype that you're talking about, not stereotype, but the model that you're talking about the exotic Jewess.
Yeah.
I think that's really fascinating, and the underlying monster thing. I think I could think of examples of that. Again, because Jewishness is not quite in the same category that it was at the time that was a thing in terms of like exoticness, like it's changed over time in terms of the role in America. But to me, the thing about Broad City is it has nothing to do with other people looking at those two women or whether they're not even seductive. They're just, of course, they're sex. They're just horny girls, but they're not even that horny. They're just like, they're just young women in their 20s. The great thing about the show is that the show, the women themselves are like joyful, extremely close friends who are unconcerned about other people looking at them and whether other people think they're hot. And in fact, their whole relationship is this complicated, close relationship that's both a friendship and also an unrequited love on the part of Alana for Abby. But the thing is, there's no question in that show. I mean, it was exciting to see women on the air who are gorgeous and hot in ways that aren't usually shown because hot Jewish women get cast with non-Jewish actresses. It happens all the time. These are two Jewish actresses who are really good looking in a way that's very familiar to Jewish women. But the show does not seem to me to be even mildly concerned with what anybody else thinks about how they look or about whether they're sexually desirable. It's a show about their appetites and their relationship to one another. So I actually, you know, like I know I reacted negatively to it, but I think that's like in comparison, for instance, Rachel Bloom on Crazy Ex-Girlfriend is a character who's very concerned with how she seems to other people, like whether she's making mistakes, whether her sex is like whether she's too sexually omnivorous, whether she's monstrous. And, you know, her song, Your Stupid Bitch, is all about self-loathing. The freeing thing about Broad City is it has nothing about to do with self-loathing. It's literally
it's about self-acceptance and no shame. I agree with you completely, and I think that they don't care about paper. In fact, Joan Rivers and Amy Schumer are their humor is responding to patriarchy. You know, the trap of patriarchy. The like.
Yeah, I think that's true, and I think there's a place for both kinds of comedy. I think there's
Broad City. Patriarchy is irrelevant to them. They're in a world of their own making. So I think I misrepresented what this professor was saying. He's saying they merge these two halves themselves.
They make a united person.
Monster with a beautiful woman. And that's how they see themselves. They see themselves as kind of queer or genderless in a way, in a strange way. Like that.
I also just don't see them as acting in masculine ways. Like I don't, maybe I'm just like.
Typically masculine ways in the sense that they are like a buddy comedy, you know, like a dude.
Yes,
buddy comedy.
Like, they're also acting like Laverne and Shirley. Like, that's yeah. to me the legacy of that show is the sort of like the two girls.
Is it really
interesting what you say about it being a comedy without patriarchy? Because some of my favorite episodes, like there's one where they get stuck to those two huge balls that are like wires sticking out of them. So it's like there sort of is, but it's true. They're kind of unaffected by sexism. Like that.
Yeah, they've chosen to transcend it in a way. And they've also chosen to both love and transcend any Jewish limitation, you know, limitation that Jewish stereotypes might bring to them or come about. They just embrace.
Well, one of the things that's so great about the sorry.
I was going to say,
one of the things that's so great about the show is that that show, unlike like Marion Rota or something, like neither of them is the main character and the other one is their crazy like female sidekick who gets to do all these crazy things, but it's sort of messed up. Like, it's not like that. Like, you know, like Alana, who might be on another character, sort of like a little bit like Mona Lisa, whatever her name is, Saperstein. And get to do, like, you know, they're both full characters. And frankly, Abby, who seems pretty normal when you first start watching the show, extremely weird. So I don't know. I miss that show.
Is that show a revolution? And what does that have to do with them being millennials, kind of the youngest of these showrunners?
I think the show was very refreshing, specifically because all of these other very exciting breakthrough shows had much darker angles to them, and they definitely dealt more with self-loathing, like Girls does and Crazy Ex-Girlfriend does. And I can probably think of like many other shows that have these.
And you talk about how Joan Rivers is all about self-loathing.
Is all about self-loathing and about using that as the engine for her success and it matching with the misogyny of the time. And it's like, she's a very complicated figure in this. I think Amy Schumer is very different than Joan Rivers in that way. Mm-hmm. She comments on that stuff, especially on her show. I like Amy Schumer a lot. But yes, the reason that Broad City felt refreshing was that you just don't feel the weight of that. That said, one of the things that I felt I remember when Broad City came out is it always bugs me when people are like, finally, there's Broad City that's better than Girls, or like the finally, you know, like people would like always compare the shows as though, like, or frankly, when Girls came out, they were like, good, here's Girls. We hate Sex in the City, and now we have Girls, so that's better than Sex in the City. And I'm like, to me, it's true that they're millennials, but they're that's part of the appeal of the show and the politics of it, definitely the sexual politics, but. Mm-hmm. I like what I felt about it was this huge, you know, what do they call the daisy wheel where you spin it around? And I'm like, this is an option that was needed. Like it was something that was freeing, but it didn't, I don't feel like it replaces or.
No. And in fact, they say actually their inspirations are like our Seinfeld and Curb Your Enthusiasm and Sex of the City, not Girls so much. I find the show to be radically liberating because they are not pinned down by limitations within or without. It is 3:15. I'm gonna turn us over to some questions, Emily, and then hopefully we'll have time to wrap up. Okay, we touched so superficially on everything. I'm so frustrated.
And also, there are dramas out there too. Like Orthodox and Schtissel and we were talking about comedies mostly, but.
Yes, and it's really interesting that we were, Better Things, Russian Doll.
My God, Better Things. Yeah, absolutely. Like, and she fits, I feel like that show fits very much into what we were talking about this like complicated, somewhat alienating character.
Flawed.
Kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah. But,
yeah, it's a great subject and it's an exciting time.
It's an exciting time and I have so much to say about her, but I'm going to go to some questions, excuse me, about Sam Fox and Pamela Adlon. But okay, so here's somebody. Is there a difference between how male and female critics perceive Jewish women protagonists and how does this affect the success of a show? Male and female critics, how they perceive Jewish women protagonists.
I think this is an interesting question, but I'm always extremely unsatisfying this on this because I just am unwilling to draw large conclusions about the way that women critics versus male critics respond to this. To me, the great thing about TV criticism, and I will say as opposed to movie criticism by and large, is that it's a really far more gender mixed. I mean, it could use more diversity on all levels, but a lot of times when I've been arguing about these shows, I'm arguing about them with a mixture of male and female critics. I think that the male critics that I know have often had incredibly insightful things to say about these shows. The one thing I think is the difference is just if you're a guy and there's a show that's like a breakthrough feminist show, you may be more hesitant to say critical things about it. I think there's a freedom if your identity matches what the show is. I think sometimes it frees critics up to feel like they have the authority to actually say something critical about a show that is being acclaimed for being, you know, a breakthrough and positive role models and stuff. That's the only difference I see. I mean, you know, there are individual reviews by male critics that I've occasionally read that I'm like, that's tone deaf or sexist, but I don't think that's by and large true of male critics. And I think, I mean, some of my favorite critics are like, I will say one weird thing is that male critics loved Girls. It was a weird show because it was so divisive, and so, but middle-aged men were actually into that show when it came out. And I think that that's a whole complicated thing because a lot of the most celebratory pieces about it were actually written by men, and a lot of the most scathing, some of them insightful, but some of them I found frustrating pieces were written by women. So it's like, that's a while ago at this point. It feels like time is passing in such a warped way that it feels like it's decades ago, but it, you know, it depends on the show. So I wouldn't say that there's the overall sense that men, you know, like, unless there's like a really piggy guy who just likes to say nasty things about Jewish women on the air, but none are coming to mind offhand.
And it's going to be interesting to see what, like, the future male showrunners, you know, who, you know, Woody Allen, et cetera, you know, were and Philip Roth, how they created these, as you said, you know, these damaging stereotypes. They really ran with them, the Jewish mother, the Jap.
I think it's also like, I always say this just because it's true. Like, it's important that there be women showrunners. Like, that's absolutely true of all backgrounds and types. And it's important that there be people from various marginalized communities creating stuff. But that having those people doesn't guarantee that you create a certain kind of art. And TV is a highly collaborative medium. Writers' rooms are about a unified mind. I mean, shows are made in different ways. And when I was listening to Treva Silverman talk about Mary Tyler Moore show and helping out creating Rhoda, one of the interesting things is she was like, I remember a lot more about writing for Lou. And she also said that she based Ted Baxter's character a lot on her mother. So I don't think it's that clear cut. It's not like women write for women, Black people write for Black people. Like,
What? And that's Jenji Cohen's argument that anyone can write anyone versus.
I'm not sure I agree with Jenji completely on that, because I actually do think it's incredibly important to have varied voices in the room so people aren't like the one girl writer or the one Indian writer or whoever. But at the same time, I do think it doesn't just come down to like, if you have a person of a certain identity, you will have better and more authentic art. I think that the main thing is a variety of people creating in very different aesthetics. Like, that's the dream, is that you should have, as there were a couple of years ago, 3 Black showrunners and ABC creating radically different shows. Then you get to have a conversation. It's only when you have one person that it's a nightmare.
Which is why we're able to have this conversation right now, because we have these, and you know, I wanted to talk to you more about the female gaze and what it means in terms of these shows, but I'm gonna go on to another question. Just wanted to make sure I threw in the term female gaze.
Yes. We could have a whole separate argument about the female gaze. As I did, frankly, years ago on a panel about Transparent and Orange is the New Black in a different era. It's a fascinating
question. Yes, I know that panel, and I know there was a big argument about whether it's possible or whether it's real or important between Joey and Jenji.
Yes.
Okay, Janice Plotkin. Hi, Janice. What is the most familiar but least stereotyped of Jewish women characters?
The most familiar but least stereotyped?
So I guess when we talk about stereotypes, I think of Jap, I think of Jewish mother, I think of kind of working class funny lady like Fran Drescher or maybe even the Broad City Girls, kind of, you know, Ilana maybe comes into that. And then now this new one that I've gonna be percolating on the beautiful Jewess who's oversexed and yet.
That's an interesting question, because I was actually looking, when I was looking over the characters I was thinking of, I was looking for somebody who was a really like off the beaten track character. And I don't think that to me, it's not a matter of stereotype. It's a matter of there's certain types of Jewish women that do get represented a lot. And one thing I love is the animated show Big Mouth, which is this very fascinatingly both sweet and filthy show about like junior high school kids and sex, is a very Jewish show. And it has a lot of great writing. And Jessie Klein is on the show. And she plays this wonderful.
That's Jewish a great character.
It's a great character. And Missy is also Jewish. Missy, the biracial character, a young girl who's a nerd, who's into sci-fi. I mean, you could, if you wanted to, you could be like, those are stereotypical things, but they're not. Like the characters feel very specific. And so both of those characters, who are both Jewish girls, who have completely different issues, like Jessie has these issues about her parents getting divorced, her mom has an affair with a woman who's the cantor Dina at her temple. There's a whole
played by Michaela.
All of this is about Jewishness, and it does seem to me to be, it steps outside, it's not like a totally radical category. It's not like some random Jewish woman who's a fisherman in Alaska, so you've never seen anything like that. But I feel like those are rich and full characters in an unexpected place, and they're not they're literally cartoons, but they're not cartoonish. So I like that show.
I love, you know, what I'm getting from this conversation is that the opposite of stereotype is specificity.
I do think that's true. I mean, again, because I'm always caveating everything, I'm like, there are times, depending on the kind of show you're writing, that you can do something that's about the stereotype. But yes, I maintain
that all the shows that we were honing in on are dealing with certain stereotypes but subverting them. And I think there's so much more. Okay. Here's another question from Diane Wolf. The stereotypes portrayed of a wealthy Jewish family and their princessy daughter in The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel really made me cringe. Did they disturb you at all? And you did say that.
Well, you know what's funny about it is that somebody, first of all, the reason stuff on that show made me cringe is complicated, because the world that's being portrayed there is definitely a real world. Like wealthy Jewish families on the Upper East Side, who had that like incredible concern with appearance and status, is a real section of Jewish history and a real cultural thing. So it's not made up, but does it step eerily into kind of stereotypical ideas of Jewish women as just vapid, greedy princesses? It does. And to me, part of it is the question of like, is it done well or is it done poorly? Of course, the show also has a working class Jewish woman, because Susie is Jewish, right?
Yes.
Susie's a butch lesbian, but Susie, and I hate it because I know that people love the show, but it's not a show I like. And to me, the problem is, again, it's like, how is it done? It could work if it felt real, but I feel like Susie's a missed opportunity. Like, there's a big gay and lesbian subculture in the world that they're showing, but they never show it. So instead you see Susie, she's a working class Jewish woman, but she has no sex life. She's a sexless character. So I feel like there are things in the show that make me cringe, and it's partially because I think they're done poorly. It's not because they show wealthy, shallow women. I could think of shows in which they show a similar kind of materialism. Actually, it's interesting because I'm more bothered by Jewel's parents, because I feel like their portrayal as coarse, like Polish Russian, like factory owner, greedy, corrupt
caricature.
People, they feel like a real caricature to me. I was genuinely confused about the background of Midge's parents, because I was like, wait, are they like, I started asking online, are they wealthy German people? Is like the father is a, like, how do they have this money? He works as a, anyway, they resolved some of that later on, but I do feel like, I understand why people found it anxiety provoking, but I have to say, I don't think that they're, I mean, I think she's portraying something real. like that thing, like that's what Joan Rivers was dealing with. Like Joan Rivers literally painted, her parents painted their kitchen pink so that her, and I think she had a sister, would look nicer so that if guys came over, they would find her attractive. Like that's, you know.
Light would look better. I think it's also, it's Joan Rivers and it's Marjorie Morningstar had a baby, you know, I think. Okay. Here is, oh, what do you make of the rise of Jewish women of color as we saw in the clip reel?
Yes. I mean, you know, who was shown, like it was cool because they showed from Grey's Anatomy, that was a great little shot.
I'm Jewish.
And there's a couple of different characters like this. I mentioned Missy on Big Mouth because it's interesting because, I don't know, Jenny Slate plays the character and she just stepped down.
Left, right?
Yeah, there's a big discussion about like who gets to play who. And I think it's a complicated discussion that goes beyond the realm of this. Part of her thinking was that she was like, that character is half Black, half Jewish. I'm Jewish. Yeah. So it's okay for me to play the role. And she ended up stepping down from it. I mean, it's funny. I was thinking about how on the Black Jewish characters, they're far and few between. I was able to find a few. I mean, it's great. Tiffany Haddish does this whole Black Mitzvah thing at the beginning of her, it's a very funny comedy show and I enjoyed it, but there's a lot of, I mean, there's a lot of half Black, half Jewish actors. They don't tend to play half Black, half Jewish.
Ross, Debbie Diggs.
Yeah. Like all three of the siblings of Bo on Blackish are all from half Black, half Jewish families, but Bo and those characters are not like Debbie Diggs and I'm sorry, what's her name? Rashida Jones. Right, and I'm sorry, I'm like, you mess up everybody's name. But all three of those characters are they're biracial characters who are played as being from a family with hippie parents who are a white dad and a Black mom, but they don't have a Jewish parent. In real life, they all have Jewish parents. So I mean, you know, I hope, like, I don't want to be utopian about TV. Every time I go out to LA and I say, it's a great time for women creators, everybody's like, it's not that great. It's actually very hard to get stuff greenlighted.
I want to acknowledge that too, that even though it's a heyday and it's a room, we have to go.
Yeah. But I'd like to see more of this kind of representation.
And I think,
I know Rashida Jones plays the sister on the show, not Tracy Ellis Ross. Tracy Ellis Ross plays the main character, plays Bo, but Rashida Jones, isn't it Rashida Jones who plays her sister on the show, or is it somebody else? Because I know she plays her on Black AF, but I
Black
thought
AF she plays.
But I thought who play? Am I getting stuff confused here? Because who plays Bo's sister on Blackish?
Blackish. I don't know.
Either way, I mean, Rashida Jones is also on Black AF playing a different version of Kenya's wife. So anyway.
And and we also have Cindy, Black Cindy on Orange is
Oh my
New
God,
Black.
I was wrong. I occluded the two characters, so I apologize.
Okay.
I included Rashida Jones, who is on Black AF with the actress who plays the sister on the thing. I overlapped them.
Got it. That makes sense though, because it's the same showrunner, right? Isn't it?
Well, it's the same. It's a portrait of the same family.
Kenya Barris, yeah. I just wanted to say Black Cindy from Orange is the New Black.
Yes, she's great.
Say her name, part of this. And Nikki Nichols from Orange is the New Black, which are both, I think are both Jewish women characters who are 10 years ahead, like they're 10 years ahead. They're what I hope we see more of. And they're fantastic. Okay, one more question here. Time to wrap up, I'm being told. Okay, I'm just gonna ask one more question here and then I'm gonna wrap up. So we're gonna take an additional 3 or 4 minutes of our time. I hope that's okay. So there's been a righteous push to demand that non-white roles be portrayed by the appropriate non-white person. Oh, this is like the what you were just talking about with Big Mouth. I'd love to hear insight on how this maps to the Jewish female experience, Rachel Brosnahan, Jennifer Aniston. Is the imperative to be represented by ourselves the same as for other people of color groups? Why and why not?
different people feel very differently about this. I am a case-by-case basis person. I actually really have no problem with great performances by non-Jewish performers playing Jewish women. And I also have no problem with Jewish women playing non-Jewish women. But there are exceptions, and Rachel Brosnahan is one of them, because I think that that show is so much about the idea that she is beautiful, mm-hmm. and she clearly, to me, looks Irish Catholic rather than Jewish. And so, to me, misogynist ideas about Jewish beauty end up being embedded in the casting. So I think there are things like this. I read some criticism of them having Tracy Ullman play Betty Friedan on Mrs. America. I thought she was great casting, and I kind of didn't even feel like it was possible that that another person could play that role. Like, I thought she was really, really terrific in that. I tend not to be a stickler for this. Like, I get kind of excited by some of the transformative possibility of performance. But I will say, as with a lot of cross-identity performance, there is a problem with the fact that for a long time, nobody who looked Jewish could be considered beautiful or plausible as a main character. So that in itself does want me to, and I do find with something like Broad City, there it is a particularly